test.
Test.
Hey, how you doing, family?
Hello.
Hey, we glad to see you all. I'm glad to see y'all came and joined us again tonight.
We're so glad you guys joined us. Isn't it so cool talking to our virtual audience?
Yeah, our virtual family.
Our virtual family.
It's
we
gotten
love it.
Bigger.
It's grown.
Since, yeah, it is. It's been growing week after week. As God has just been showing in great ways that there's no stopping his church. Listen, no virus can stop us. And this is a great demonstration that God's church is bigger than brick and mortar. Aren't you excited about that? Hey, listen, so tonight what we're going to be doing is Lady C and I wanted to take some time as we recognize this has been a very stressful time for everyone.
Everyone.
And most importantly, it's been very challenging for individuals that are married as there's some things that maybe within your union, your job gave you an opportunity to escape from by going to work for those few hours. Having the kids at school was a little bit of a break for you two. But now since you're in the house together.
Or going to the gym.
You're right.
That was
going
a release.
To the gym. You're right. Going to the movies or going the movies. To the mall. All that stuff
or
is
Or wandering through Barnes & Noble.
Wandering through Barnes & Noble.
Sitting in Starbucks. Those were all releases or outlets that we as couples had a month ago. But
or even shopping. Shopping.
Why do you have to point to me when say shopping?
Well, because that's just your thing. It's shopping.
Is that my thing?
Yeah, it is.
That is.
Fellas, maybe your lady's like my lady. She slips stuff in the house and then try to tell me that, oh, I had that for a while.
But
see, I pay attention. Like, I catch up to stuff like earrings and stuff like that. Yeah, those are real nice. When did you get those? Yeah, she know what I'm talking about.
Ladies, so. It can be quite challenging when you have a man who pays attention.
Yeah,
it's very hard to sneak new items in the house.
And can I tell y'all something? She got it from her grandmother.
Don't tell my grandmother.
Don't tell her that. Don't tell her that.
But anyway.
Okay, all right. So listen, hey, so tonight we're going to spend some time trying to help couples, those that are married, those who are single. And listen, tonight this teaching that we're, before we get to it, we want you to know, we're going to ask you if you would like and share this and start a watch party and try to get this out to as many people as possible. Our church was blessed by it in an immense and great way the first time around, and we believe that it's going to help even a greater number of people. Before we dive into this teaching, I want to share with you all a really great resource. You can find it in your app store. It's called Relationship TV. Listen, I am so glad that Camille and I can stand behind this great resource because it has great content to help you in building relationships, not only for your intimate relationships between your husband or your wife, but also in relationships with your business and with family members or friends. And listen, it's free.
So check it out. We encourage you, download the app.
Yes.
You see a picture right on the screen. It says RETV. When I tell you the amount of resources and the wealth of information and connectivity that Ty and Cody, who are the owners and founders of this website and this business, they are just really, really, really have a heart for couples and individuals and just seeing everyone progress and be their best. So we encourage you, get to the app RETV, log in, plug in, and you know, you will be helped.
Absolutely, you definitely will be. And so listen, tonight, we want you to grab your Bible, grab your notebook. Hear me now. Get your spouse with you. If you're single, sit with your phone, a notebook, and your Bible, and take notes to prepare yourself for when you cross that bridge of getting married. Hey, are y'all ready? No. Are y'all really ready?
You can't hear them clapping?
I know, they about to jump. I see some hands about to just reach through the camera
on us.
Yeah,
they're ready.
I believe
they're ready.
All
so
right.
If you all are ready, we encourage you. And we want to remind you, the session you're about to see is pre-recorded.
Yes.
So we want to be sure to let everyone know no one else is in the sanctuary with us right now. But it's pre-recorded, good information. We're going to come back at the end to take questions again like we did last night.
Yeah.
You all had really good questions. There were some questions we weren't able to get to, so we want to do that tonight.
Absolutely. So listen, with no further ado, let's dial in. Let's check out this teaching on loving your spouse. Would you stand to your feet? We're going to get ready to read God's word. Turn with us to Deuteronomy chapter 24 and verse 5. Deuteronomy chapter 24 and verse 5. And I'm going to be reading from the New American Standard Bible. And it reads as such. It says, when a man takes a new wife, he shall not go out with the army, nor be charged with any duty. He shall be free at home 1 year and shall give happiness to his wife whom he has taken. Remain standing and go with us to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. It's in the New Testament. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, starting at verse 1. If you happen not to have a copy of God's word, look on with someone next to you, because I have found that God's word is so sharp, so such a great tool that just reading God's word can transform your life. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 reads as this. It says, now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is not good for a man to touch a woman. Verse 2. But because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife. Can you say that with me? His own wife. And each woman is to have her own husband. Can you say that with me? Own husband. Verse 3 says, the husband must fulfill his duty to his wife, and likewise also the wife to her husband. And listen, this morning, for the time that you and I have together, I just simply want to title this time that we have together, Giving Your Spouse Love. Giving Your Spouse Love. And as you're being seated, let us pray together this morning. Father in heaven, thank you now for all you've done for us. Thank you for your love and kindness towards us and your mercy. And Lord, we thank you for how you have taken care of us and provided for us this far. We ask you now, Lord God, that you would speak to us this morning. And we ask you that you would give us clarity of mind and thought. Give us receptive hearts and listening ears. Give us hearts and minds that are willing to obey what we hear today. I pray, Lord God, that you would allow all that's said and done be done for your glory. I ask that you would strengthen marriages where love is not in the home. And Lord, I pray that those homes where love already exists, I pray that you would strengthen and undergird it in a great way. And Lord, I pray for those that are single that are here, our single adults, and also for our teenagers that are here. I pray that you would open their eyes to the value of what your word has to say as it pertains to the love that each of us need. Thank you for your faithfulness and you doing these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen. You know, love and sex is something that is often talked about, except in the house of God. You see it on TV, you see it in movies, it's in magazines, you're on social media. Everyone's advertising and trying to tell you and I about what love is and how it should be displayed and exchanged between people. And unfortunately, most Christians won't admit that that's really what's on their mind. They need some answers to it. And so we get a chance to see this morning from 1 Corinthians chapter 7 that God has an answer for every single thing that can come across a human's mind. Some of you all think you wouldn't find out about love and sex and intimacy between a husband and a wife in the Bible. Yes, you will. Every single life experience that you can think of is right in God's word. And so this morning, as we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul shows you and I that, listen here, my brother, my sister, it doesn't make you strange when you ask questions. Do you hear what I'm saying? Some of us have been told as kids, you don't ask adult questions, or you don't ask God questions. Listen, God is not afraid of your questions. He actually warmly receives your questions. And here is the thing that some of the old church fathers came up with. They came up with a term in Latin. It's called sola scriptura. Meaning scripture alone, meaning the Bible can stand by itself without any other resources for you and I to get clarity on the answers that we have. And so what the Apostle Paul shows us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1 is that the Corinthian church, just like our church, had questions about sex and marriage. And is it really for a lifetime? What happens if I don't get pleasure when I get married to them? What happens if promises are not fulfilled? What happens if the economy collapses and the big white house with the white picket fence is no longer a reality?
Or what happens if your spouse gets ill and they can no longer have sex with you?
Yes.
That happens.
Yes.
And we have to consider all of these things when we are considering joining in union with someone.
Absolutely. And so look at what the Apostle Paul says to you and I. He says, it is not good for a man, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Reason we had our younger kids leave and I asked specifically for our teenagers to remain here is because we need to have a realistic, honest conversation, okay, this morning. And so our intent is that over the course of this month, we're going to get a chance to hear from both the male and female perspective with my wife and I working together on this, that the Apostle Paul says to you and I, my brother and my sister, sex, when it is experienced, can become addictive. It is a treasure that is really supposed to be remained to be used only between one man, one woman for a lifetime.
In marriage.
In marriage. Thank you so much. Walk down the aisle, made some vows before God. If it was done in a chapel or the courthouse or in back Big Mama's backyard, y'all made a commitment to God before you got into marriage. See, some of you all looking at me strange and say, why he got to say all of that? Because there are some of us that we've been together so long, we're settling for common law marriage. But listen, my brother, my sister, you doing nothing but playing house. If you're going to do this thing, let's do it right. Listen, I love the way Beyonce put it. She said, if you like it, put a ring on it. And that goes for both ways. And he says this to you and I because, listen up, my brother, my sister, the sexual experience is so enjoyable that it will cause you and I to want to go back for more. See, here's the problem that I don't like about church people. Y'all sit there looking real stoic. Like, how you think you got here? How did the kids you got, how did they get here? They didn't just magically appear. Maybe you might have adopted them, but for most of the folks in here, it happened because you and somebody else got together and laid down. You enjoyed the time that was together, or maybe you didn't, but they're here now. Do you understand what I'm saying?
And I think that when we're looking in Corinthians, Paul was writing this letter because sexual immorality and the temptation had become so great.
Yes.
And we ain't got to look back to the Corinthian church. We can look right here in Milwaukee.
Absolutely.
If you just turn your TV on, it's right in front of us.
Absolutely.
You know, when I was coming up, when I was a lot younger, there were no commercials with women in underwear.
Yeah.
That just didn't happen.
Yeah.
The TV shows that were on when I was a young kid, they slept in separate beds. The husband, it was very different. So we are being faced and we are being bombarded by the evil spirit of sexual immorality.
Yes.
It is an evil spirit.
Yes.
It's not playtime.
Yes.
We have children in schools, 5, 6, 8, 9, that have already been introduced to pornographic imaging.
Yes.
So if we are not having these conversations here, somebody's gonna have it with your child on the playground.
Absolutely.
And the conversation they'll get, you don't want them to get.
Yes.
So it behooves us to dive into our word and look at how God was so gracious to us that he walks us through each area of life.
Absolutely.
And he gives us specific instruction on how to manage your life as a single person who desires sex.
Absolutely.
As a married person who you may be married and you may still desire sex and you may not be getting it from your spouse.
Yes.
That happens too. So those of us who think, oh, I want to get married to have sex, newsflash. Let me give you a real big newsflash. When the cares of this world start happening, that's the last thing on your mind. I can only speak for women.
So
I can only speak for women. I'll say that again.
Oh, man, I don't want to jump ahead here.
Don't jump ahead. Yeah.
So listen up. The reason Paul answers these questions for the church is because there are some big questions that are happening in the area of the in realm of the church. There are some people who think you're more holy and sacred if you remain abstinent all your life.
The wearing of the long skirts does not make you holy and sacred.
Absolutely.
That's not that doesn't happen.
And so also the Apostle Paul has another dilemma on the other end. There are other individuals who feel that self-fulfillment is and pleasure should be the ultimate goal for every person. So you have these Jewish brothers and sisters who some of them feel that life should be lived really strict, very forced. And then you also have these Greek and Roman brothers and sisters who they've grown up all their lives knowing and understanding that life should be fulfilled. It should be lived. Whatever it is I desire to do, I should seek after it, and I should fulfill myself in whatever way that I see. And so Paul stops to say, listen, it's not either or, it's both and. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
So he has to lay out the groundwork for you and I to understand God has no problem with you and I enjoying intimacy, but as long as it's done between one man, one woman, for a lifetime.
Amen.
I got to stop here for a moment because some of us will say, well, brother pastor, I hear what you're saying. But is it okay if I find myself pleasing myself in a sexual manner, but it's not with another person?
That's why we didn't want the kids in here.
That's why we want the kids in here.
Because this is real life.
Yeah.
And we have allowed the world to place shame on sex. That's not biblical.
The first commandment he gave to him in Genesis is be fruitful and multiply. That can't happen in a staring contest. I don't know about you. See, that's the problem. It's not going to happen in a staring contest. Adam and Eve had to be intimate with one another in order for them to reproduce. And because we're not, listen here. Here is the spiritual warfare that is happening. Satan is taking what God made beautiful and staining it in such a way that we don't want to talk about it.
Yeah.
We want to be shamed about it, that, and the third. He's even reframing it. That God's first command to man and woman is now to be flipped, that it can be explored between a man and a man or a woman and a woman. Or if you're kind of torn between the two, you can play both roles. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. Listen, my wife and I, and I'm going to say this to some of you all that are parents, my wife wound up showing me something. She wound up getting sent from something from somebody about a video game called Roblox. My son loves playing that game. We have put the phone in his hand. I'm saying to you, those of you that are parents, you got to start sitting down, watching this stuff, and researching the stuff that you're putting in the hands of your kids to keep them preoccupied. That she showed me this video where they were showing the characters in Roblox where the kids could make them have sex in the game.
Someone had gotten into the game system and the characters were having an orgy.
Yes.
In the game. When I tell you the spirit of sexual immorality is running rampant.
Yes.
And if it can attach itself to your child at a young age.
Yeah.
Because you know how you felt when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Let us all reflect on back.
Yeah.
If we can remember, when we were introduced, it was almost like Pandora's box had opened.
Yeah.
And the only way that it can be closed is by the power of God.
Absolutely.
Not by a seminar, not by a book. The power of God has to release you from the stronghold.
Yes.
Because it is a stronghold.
Yes, it is. It is. So before we move on, there's another principle that Paul says to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. Look what he says again. Now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. So what the Apostle Paul is implying to you and I is that if you're single, abstinence is not a suggestion, it is a command. If you are not married, that means you shouldn't be exploring masturbation or self-pleasure. Listen, Jesus says he who looks upon a woman and lusts in his heart is guilty of the sin of sexual immorality or fornication already because they thought it through in their heart and mind. Listen, you even got to be cautious about the movies that you're watching. You find yourself watching a movie and it's this sexual scene that takes place and you find those sexual desires rising up for you to begin to lust after the character and thinking through things in your mind or trying to even compare what would happen between your spouse, you and your spouse, or listen here, my brother, my sister, inviting other individuals into your home to be involved in a sexual act between you and your spouse, or watching pornographic images while you all are being intimate.
And we are, I want you all to really take heed to what we are saying.
Yeah.
We've done our research. These are things that have become normal. These are normal practices that people are engaging in, and Christians as well.
Absolutely.
This is not something we're, if you look at the statistics and look at the world and the way in which it's moving, Satan has put a chokehold on sex. And he's making bad look good. He's making evil look good. And if you've ever seen the movie, I'm a big movie buff. If you've ever seen the movie, and it was Vampire in Brooklyn. He was standing in the church. He was outside. I think the church was outside. He kept saying, evil is good.
Everybody say it with me.
And the whole church started saying, evil is good. Because here's the thing. If you're not reading your word, if you are not involving and engaging with like-minded Christians, you will begin to say evil is good.
So let's look at this next verse here in verse 2. Paul says, but because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife. Can you say that with me? His own wife.
Own wife.
And each woman is to have her own husband. Say with me, her own husband.
Her own husband.
Paul says to you and I, hear me now. There are some of us who may not have never been intimate before with someone else, but have a high sex drive. Paul says to you and I, pump your brakes, slow down for a moment. The joy of intimacy between one man and one woman is only reserved for those who got license. It's only supposed to happen between one man, one woman, for a lifetime. And he says that, listen, if it is an issue that you need that and you feel you need that sense of fulfillment sexually, then you should allow for marriage to be a priority. It's not a license to say, well, man, I just can't contain myself, so I'm going to just run out here to whoever looks good and just go down to the courthouse and sign some papers so we can color together at home. No, that ain't what he's saying. But if you understand, listen, okay, let me bring it home for you. If you know you dating someone right now, right, and y'all love each other and you care for each other and y'all been together for around that 2-year mark or it's been longer than that, when is the real conversation about marriage going to start happening? Because the reality is this. Y'all keep watching a few more movies late at night with the shades closed and the movie on and the kids sleep. Guess what's going to happen? It's something going to lead to something and something going to lead to something else, right? Okay, so some of y'all get past that boundary, right? Okay, a few walks in the park late at night, ain't nobody else around. Curiosity going to start speaking. That touching is going to move to touching somebody there and touching somebody else in this other kind of way. That the temptation will increase more and more. And Paul is saying, if you that attracted to him in that type of way and y'all both have those feelings, stop messing around and make a commitment and you can enjoy the whole package together in a way that God is God honoring.
And let's go back to last month and you've gone over that list of questions. Because sex should not drive your reason to marry.
Absolutely.
Because you will be gravely disappointed.
Absolutely.
When the marriage does happen and life starts happening, marriage is not about sex.
Yeah.
Marriage is about two people coming together for the benefit of the kingdom.
Yes.
If you are not kingdom-minded and you are sex-driven, you can catch yourself marrying the wrong person.
Yeah.
And then where do you go? And then what happens when you are now locked in to something that you didn't think through? You allowed your flesh and your desires to make your decision.
Yeah.
Let's all raise our hands if we would have married the first person we had sex with.
Oh.
I'll wait.
Yeah.
We got one and a half people.
Yeah, one and a half out of hundreds of people here.
Because your desire, most of the times when we're leading with our desires, we're not even thinking clearly.
Absolutely. So look at what Paul says to us, and we're going to talk about some other stuff here. Verse 3. The husband must fulfill his duty to his wife, and likewise also the wife to her husband. We started out this morning reading Deuteronomy chapter 24 and verse 5. Now hear me now. The Bible makes clear to you and I that a man who would be serving in the military, because marriage is such an important union, could not even fulfill his military service because he was supposed to stay at home and bring happiness and pleasure and enjoyment and just spent in learning and loving his bride.
Yes,
yes. I'm gonna say to those of you here who are married, or maybe you already been married for a while, if you just recently got married, and as Camille and I began to learn, that first year is vitally important. It's just time that really should be spent between the two of y'all just learning to get to know each other.
Right.
Let me say this to you. If you just recently got married and you got folks living up in your house, God bless their heart and mind. We got a nice cot waiting on them right over here in the Learning Center. I know this is real harsh and real kind of difficult for some of us to kind of swallow, but that first year is so valuable.
Yeah.
Because you think you really know the person, but you don't know what it's like to wake up next to them in the morning. Yeah, you see him every day. Y'all talk every day. But you don't know what it's like when the pressures and the cares of this world, how does that weigh on them when no one else is around? How do you comfort them? How do they get to know you? Because listen here, my brother, my sister, in order for the marriage to really be enjoyable, like Camille mentioned about, y'all ain't having sex every single day for you to be saying you enjoying and to be pleased. It's like, listen, because you can still be having sex every day and not want to come home when you get off of work. But what we're talking about is healthy, thriving marriages where you all enjoy seeing each other. You listen, instead of saying you glassy away on the girl's trip, you should be hungry and thriving and excited that she on her way back home. Man, when's she going to get back? Me and the boy looking out the window. When they going to roll up? Where y'all at? What landmark did y'all just pass by? Why she ain't answering her phone? I'm FaceTiming her. Don't she know we want to just see
and
her
husbands
face?
Need boundaries.
All right.
Okay? Let me enjoy the girl's trip.
So, listen here for a moment. Listen here for a moment. Then we're going to move on because we want to talk about some other things here. So, the Apostle Paul says to you and I, he says that the husband must fulfill his duty to his wife. I hope you got your Bible out and you're looking at this with your spouse. And likewise, also the wife to the husband. Before you begin to talk about sexual, being intimate sexually in a physical way, God says to you and I, that the feeling is mutual. It's a mutual responsibility that both man and woman must be concerned about fulfilling the desires, meeting the love language of their spouse.
Yes. Yes.
Listen, we can't even today, if you came today thinking we're going to talk about the physical stuff, we ain't going to get to that today. We're going to talk about that next week. Because listen, when the emotional needs get met, the physical going to follow.
Okay.
You ain't hearing what I'm saying. Whether you man or woman, if my emotional needs get met, guess what? You ain't even got to say nothing. It's going to be like Zechariah and Elizabeth up in the house all week long. If you meet my, see, a few of y'all are some Bible readers, so you know what I'm talking about. The rest of y'all, read your Bible. Just read your Bible. And I knew that flew over your head, but when you read your Bible, you're going to go home and say, man, now I can laugh like that. You're going to be laughing in the house. The kids are going to be like, what's going on? I'm just reading my Bible. I got what the preacher said. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Okay.
You tell the worst joke.
They laughed. They laughed. I don't know if it's just because I'm not. They laughed.
They're being nice.
They laughed. All right. So listen here. Paul says that they have to keep themselves together and fulfill their duty to each other. Track with me for a moment. I've been in the U.S. Marine Corps, served in the U.S. Marine Corps for 6 years. My duty, if I'm an infantryman and I'm out on patrol, is to be concerned about the people who are part of my team. I got to look out for their safety. While we're out on patrol, I can't fall asleep. I got to be diligent. I got to be paying attention to everything that's going on around me. Mm-hmm. See, there's some of us that are married or we're single. We're living our lives blindly, not even paying attention to what's happening with our spouses. How do they need to be cared for? And so I want to throw this out here as a plug. If you are married or if you are single, let me say this especially to those of you that are single.
Yeah.
This is going to be one of the best investments that you need to purchase for yourself. It's called The Five Love Languages. It's by a guy named Gary Chapman. If you marry, I want to encourage you to buy this book, and the two of you need to go through it together.
Amen.
Because there's going to be some things you will discover as we begin to talk about this together today that are essential for you and your wife and your spouse to make sure that you have a, thank you so much, to have a thriving, healthy marriage. So there's five love languages that he talks about, and this is going to wrap up our time together. The first one is this, and you want to jot this down, is words of affirmation. Words of affirmation. Listen here, my brother, my sister. Some of us in here, when we start to talk about love language, some of the brothers in here will say, yeah, I know what mine is. You ain't got to tell me, Pastor. It's physical touch. Man, as long as she touching me and I'm touching her, we in good graces. But can I say to you that there's some of us in here, even with the physical touch, if she chop you down with your words, the physical touch don't mean much or nothing. Because there are some of us that would prefer to get a kind word and get the physical touch, not just simply get the physical touch and you talk me down on the ground.
And so let me stop. Let me put a pin right there.
Yeah.
When you are married, and this is for single people, you need to know this, especially if you have a desire. You should not allow what is going on around you to affect what goes on here.
Yes.
But that happens often.
Yeah.
If you're stressed at work, if the kids are stressing, if you have some emotional turmoil, you will sometimes shut yourself off.
Yeah.
Not realizing that your partner is missing out because you've completely detached.
Yes.
And that affects the union in a great way.
Yes.
In a really, really big way. So we have to be conscious of, as we're moving through life, you're moving with someone.
Yeah.
Sometimes we come into marriage with, we still have a single mindset.
Yeah.
We're married, but we're single in the way we think and how we do things. That's not God honoring.
Absolutely. And let me say this, that because the responsibility is mutual, you need to know what's important to you that is your love language.
Right.
So let me back up here for a moment. It would be really difficult for Camille and I to be able to communicate if Camille only spoke Chinese and I only knew English. There would be all kind of conflicts that would happen. I would be trying to tell her, I'm hungry. Please feed me. And she would be looking at me like, what? What do you mean? Like, can you tell me? Use your hands or something. And believe it or not, that's what's happening in marriages.
Right, right.
The man is trying to show the woman, baby, I love you. I'm going to work. I'm working hard. And that's his way of trying to express that he loves her. And guess what? To her, that's pointless. That's what you're supposed to do. No. Hear me out for a moment. I'm not trying to beat you up if that's your thing. Because that's one of them is called acts of service. We're going to talk about them in a moment. But you then have to discover, how do I communicate to her or him in a way that they understand that I'm communicating in their language, that they understand that I love them, that I care for them, that they mean something to me.
So
okay?
Let me give you guys an example.
We're gonna work our way through it. Yes, we're gonna work our way through it. Sure? So we're gonna go back and forth. Yeah, we are. So don't skip ahead.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I see your hand? All right. So listen here for a moment. I want to say this before we dive into these about why this is so important. Dr. Gary Chapman brought up something that is so real, but it's honest. He says that in marriage unions, you and I operate with a love tank. Think about your love tank like a gas tank.
Mm-hmm.
Your car is not going to go far if it's on E. But when it's full, man, you can roll that thing. And what Dr. Chapman brought up that we get to see right out of here, out of the Bible, because we read here 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 3, the husband and wife are both obligated mm-hmm. to fulfill their duty to each other. Not just the physical touchy, but the emotional support that's needed to make sure that the union is healthy.
Yeah.
And listen to me closely, my brother, my sister. You may be doing all the things that you think are right, but your spouse is riding on E. That's why they're irritated all the time. That's why it seems like every time you do something wrong, they firing off on you right away because they're not getting what they need. They're thriving for the attention. They're looking for the love that they need. And you know what they're saying to you? You don't understand me. So let's listen to these five love languages. It's going to help us out. I'm going to talk to the brothers. Camille's going to talk to our ladies. So what words of affirmation look like, ladies, to a man. And leave back up for a moment before we skip ahead. For those of you who are single, you need to identify what your love language is and don't let somebody try to define it for you.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because, listen, they can take you on trips, buy cars and clothes and all that other kind of stuff, but that stuff could be meaningless. So you first got to know yourself. So first of all, so words of affirmation is the first love language. So what this looks like for a brother is this, for a man, is receiving a loving note, a text, an email. I really appreciate you. I love how you take care of the family. Thank you for going to work, working hard, take care of us and provide for us. I love your vision and the drive. Keep on going. Keep doing what you're doing. Or to hear from her, or to hear, I love you from her. You don't know sometimes how meaningful that is to just hear, I love you. Think about how far I love you could go after an argument. Mm-hmm. Maybe y'all might, listen, I know, the Bible says, don't let the sun go down in your wrath, meaning don't go to the bed, be angry at each other. Mm-hmm. But can we just be honest, sometimes that happens.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know what, yeah, you know what, man, I can't even be around you. You're mm-hmm. gonna have to go sleep on the couch tonight.
Mm-hmm.
But then in the morning after you done got a good night's sleep, and for some of us, a real good night's sleep, and then you wake up in the morning and the issue you had with your significant other, the day starts off by saying, I love you. I'm mad at you, but I really love you. You know, I got to just tell you that I love you. Or how about this? Getting a compliment by your spouse or getting a compliment by your wife for no apparent reason. Let me just throw this out here. Newsflash, public service announcement. February 14th is a Friday. February 14th, let me just speak in the microphone real clear here so you can hear me, is Valentine's Day. If you married up in here, brother, please, I'm begging you right now, especially with us talking about this stuff, man, go get a card. Go buy a bag of oranges if that's her thing. Ladies, do the same thing. To show each other that you love. Listen, let me tell you something. If words of affirmation are important and that's your love language, it's huge when you get a compliment from your wife just because. It ain't no birthday. It ain't a holiday. It ain't sweetest day. It ain't your birthday. But you just got a nice, kind remark text message, email, phone call, FaceTime, to just say that I love you. And then lastly is just to hear praise from her. And so Camille's going to talk about words of affirmation for her.
And so, you know, when you think about words, there's a saying when we came up, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That was one of the biggest lies. One of the biggest lies, because the bruise will go away, but your words I will remember for a lifetime. And so that's why Gary Chapman realized that some people's love language is just positive affirmation. I love you. You look good today. If a husband can tell someone else they look good, they should be able to tell their wife they look good.
Absolutely.
If you can be kind to your boss, you can be kind to your spouse. And it's the little things, but again, we have to do our own individual research. My husband can't tell me my love language. Only I know my love language. And remember this, sometimes your love language changes.
Yes.
Sometimes it changes. My love language used to be time. When we were younger and newly married, I just wanted him to spend time with me. My love language has changed. But affirmation, I hear the words, I appreciate you, from him, getting a compliment from your husband, hearing praise from him, he says something to encourage me. Those are just, that's affirmation. Honey, you look good. Honey, that new hair color looks good on you. I noticed those earrings. Sometimes we don't want our spouse to notice new things. I don't. Because I'm trying to hide the things. I'm tucking my Amazon boxes under the bed.
And I pay attention.
Putting Amazon boxes in the closet.
Earrings that show up still with the packaging still on them are brand new. They are not hung up. They just got here.
This morning I was getting dressed and he walks in the room.
Tell the truth and shame the devil.
He walks in the room. He looks down. Oh, those earrings look nice. Those must be new. And I'm thinking.
Yay, God.
I said, they've been hanging here all the time. What? But the little things, your husband paying attention. It's nothing like changing your hair color and he says nothing.
Yeah.
When I get a brand new wig, I expect a compliment. Hello.
And can I throw this out here too? Fellas, even as we're talking about words of affirmation, even commenting on a post on social media about something that you saw with your significant other can go a long way. Because guess what? You're not just saying it to her. You're saying it to the whole world.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. And that goes both ways for the man and the woman. You want to go to the next
one? Yeah, we'll go to the next one. We're kind of passing this along because we got our whole stage thing here. And by the way, I would encourage you to come to the Rapture. If you didn't purchase a ticket, it is a great presentation to come here to enjoy.
You can get tickets at the door.
You can get tickets at the door and also via Eventbrite. I think it might still be available at Eventbrite. So listen, we talked about words of affirmation. The next love language is quality time. So for him, for the guy, this is what it looks like. I can spend quality time with her, just the two of us. Those of us who got kids, quality time can mean a lot if it ain't you, the wife and the kids, or you, your cousin, and your wife watching TV on the couch, or you, your cousin, and your boy hanging around watching Netflix. Like, it means a lot for him just to be able to spend time with just the two of you together. Another one with quality time, what it looks like for him. I am around her even if we're not really doing anything. Sometimes it's just being in the vicinity that quality time means a lot. It could just be he's outside cutting the grass, and you just sitting on the steps. Man, that just means a lot to him.
And while he's there, we have to consider the other person.
Yeah.
A lot, and I have to keep saying this, we can get locked into ourselves.
Yeah.
You can't live like that when you're married.
Yeah.
I am not a touchy-feely type of person. Mm-hmm. I am a homebody. I like to, in the house, I like to be by myself. That doesn't work for my husband. Not at all. I'm sitting on the couch. He's walking in. I'm like, where are you going? I'm finna sit by you. And I'm thinking, this is interesting.
I can't be away from her, y'all. Me and Winston, we fight for it on our couch. We got one of them, a chaise with the couch connected. Yeah. So Camille likes to sit on the chaise part with her feet up, and me and Winston are both fighting for like the corner part. We call it the comfy spot. And me and him fight the slide to see who's going to be the closest to her and stuff like that. It's kind of funny.
But in that quality time piece, yeah. That's big for him.
Yeah.
It's huge. For me, my image of quality time is me locked somewhere in a hole just by myself with my thoughts. And that's good for me. But I have to consider my spouse.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Ladies, the same thing goes for you, gentlemen. The same thing goes for you. Like he said, some people just want you to be in the space.
Yeah.
Just as long as I know you a few feet away, that's my love language. So.
Yeah. And so here's another one here as an example. I get to do things with her. If you're a career woman that's really busy, always on the go, just being able to do stuff with you. It might be going to the grocery store, going to the mall, taking the car to go get the car washed, or whatever it is, just being able to do things together. Another one is, I sense she is showing interest in the things I care about. Is he in a hobby, participating in a sports league? Even this, ladies, hear me for a moment. I know this may not be one of the things that some of you all may not like to do. If he plays video games and you just sitting there watching him.
Ooh, that's interesting.
Could mean a whole lot to him. And so for the ladies, I know I got a few of them that just, I guess I lost the crowd there.
I don't understand. That's true.
That is true. I don't play video games, but I know that can be meaningful to some of us that do.
Whatever it is your spouse is interested in,
yeah.
You yourself should find a smidgen of interest.
Yeah.
A smidgen.
Hey, he's going to be watching the Super Bowl later on. And he might like it if you just come and sit and watch a quarter with him. I don't know, but let's go to the next one.
So let's go to
quality time for her.
Quality time for her. This is for the ladies. And we have, so it looks like you have, so quality time for ladies could mean coming to the mall with me, mm-hmm. right? Or scrolling through Amazon to find the perfect item. Right? Fellas, yes. Thank you, Sister Green. Thank you. You know, just the small things, going to, you know, maybe State Fair, and some people don't like crowds and don't like being around a lot of people, and,
yeah.
you know, just coming out into my space
yeah.
and coming around the things and the people that I enjoy. That's that quality time piece for her.
Or even going to Charmin Charlie. Or,
that's closed.
What's the other place? Alex and Amy, that kind
yeah.
of stuff? Oh, yeah, sorry. Thank you. Y'all see, I know I'm keeping up.
He has
up.
No idea.
All right, so look, the next love language is receiving gifts. So for the guy, it looks like this. She gives me a little token of our love for each other, giving him a small gift to say, you know what, I was thinking of you, and this small thing reminded me of us. Goes a long way. She surprises me with a gift. She gives me something that shows that she was really thinking of me. Or how about this? She brings me a little gift after she's been traveling. So if receiving gifts is important to that man, mm-hmm. coming back with a magnet could be just like threw him over the moon. Man, you were thinking about me and you bought me a magnet?
Mm-hmm.
Will really go a long way.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, speaking to that, a lot of times, and I can speak for regarding Pastor Monk and I, Pastor Monk is a very grand gesture type of man. So he likes to do these big, big, grand, over-the-top things. Well, when we were struggling financially, he couldn't do that.
Yeah.
So because he couldn't, it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And he was thinking, this is how I have to show her love.
Yeah.
Not realizing, I don't care about that.
Yeah.
I don't care about the big trip and the big, that wasn't for me. What I cared about is if you bought me one little candle.
Yeah, tell them about it.
Really?
Absolutely.
Is this what we're doing?
Yeah, absolutely. No, I'm saying this. No, hear me out for a moment. I'm not saying this to brag.
No,
and let me
but
say this.
He's come a long way
yes.
in understanding his wife.
Yeah.
Most people, when they see me, they think I'm a diva and I got to have all. I'm nothing like that.
Yeah.
Nothing. So the other day, he was out and about and running around, and he comes in the house with a nice Target bag. And I'm thinking, what could be in that bag? Because I love a good Target, okay? So what I find, he has a gift bag, and he has tissue paper in the gift bag. I like tissue paper, because then I have to go digging for something, right? It's the little things, right? Yeah. So I rifle through the tissue paper. There's a candle. There's a really large candle. Three beautiful small candles. There's a nice card. There were some...
An infuser. Yeah.
A really nice smelling infuser.
A coffee cup.
There was a coffee mug that said Mama Bear on it. Right there. There was some...
A card.
There was a card. There was Oil of Olay soap, yeah, which I love. The shea butter kind, I recommend. And did you have a pack of Halls in there?
Yeah, I think it was.
There was a pack of Halls.
Yeah, because she loves eating Halls.
I have to have it for my throat.
Yeah.
But it let me know that he was, not only was he thinking of me, but he knows me.
Yeah.
Right? There is a quote that says, I want to be loved, but I would rather be understood.
Yeah.
Because if you understand me, then you know how to love me.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's come a long way in regards to understanding. I don't need a big car. Mm-hmm. I don't need that. Just give me something that runs. I'm good to go. I don't need all of the accoutrement. I don't need any of that. I just need to know that you know me. And that you are thinking of me.
Yeah.
So those are important things when you are discussing marriage. When you are married, get to know your spouse.
Mm-hmm.
Know how they receive love, mm-hmm. not how you want them to receive love.
Yeah.
Because you're projecting, well, I'm showing you, and you're completely missing the mark.
Yeah. So the fourth love language is this. It's called acts of service. Okay, so this is what acts of service look like. She does something practical to help me out. She sees, you know, you see him in a jam, you come alongside and you help him
now,
out.
Now, how often do I give you acts of service?
Man, all the time.
Talk them through that.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, when people see the things that we're doing as a church and how God is been, those of you who've been here, you've been seeing our church has been growing in numbers. And our impact and reach cannot be done by myself. It's impossible. And a person who's working behind the scenes all the time to really hold things together is this woman right here. And we as a church are truly indebted to her. And that's one of the reasons why every single Sunday, whether she's here or not, we're going to celebrate Miss Irma Todd, because there's a lot that woman has done over the years to be there to comfort families, to love on individuals when they've been going through times of hardship, that she deserves just as much credit as Reverend Joe Todd for this church of being where it's at right
and
now.
And so your act of service should be what's important to that individual.
Yeah.
If taking out the garbage isn't big for them,
yeah.
that ain't gonna mean nothing.
Yeah.
But if you coming in the kitchen and saying, I'll be your sous chef, I'll cut up all the onions, I'll cut the peppers, I'll get all the spices, that's an act of service.
Yeah.
You're assisting them in something that's vital to them.
Absolutely.
The small things.
So here's a few other things. She does things for me instead of just talking about nice things. She takes care of something I'm responsible to do, but I feel too stressed to do at the time. And think about that. If you're observing your spouse going through a difficult time and you step in and say, you know what, baby, I know you normally would take the car to go get the oil change. I see you got a lot on your mind and heart. I'm gonna go take care of that. I know I ain't trying to take the place of you, but I'm gonna go ahead and take care of this just one time. That's gonna mean a lot to the person who acts of service are extremely important for. And then talk about acts of service for her.
Acts of service for her.
That
he unexpectedly does something for me like filling my car with gas or doing the laundry.
Yeah.
Or folding the clothes and putting them away.
Yeah.
Hebobo, because God knows. I wash the clothes, but folding them and figuring out where they go, that's interesting. He helps me with the task, cooking, cleaning the house, those types of things. I look forward to a holiday because of a gift I anticipate receiving from him. My loved one works on special projects with me that I have to complete.
Yeah.
So for example, I am bidding for a contract in another state, and I don't like paperwork. I'm not interested. Mm-hmm. I just need to get to the point. But in the process of this bid, there's 58 pages of paperwork that I have to look through. I don't like to do it. That falls on him. And I know he'll be thorough, and he'll come back and say, well, did you see this? Did you look over that? Well, what about this? So those types of things are acts of service. Or he helps me out, especially if I know he is already busy. So men, pay attention. If you're dating, pay close attention to what she's interested in and see how you can assist.
Yeah. All right. And then our last one is physical touch. You know we couldn't leave here without talking about that. So physical touch, for him, she and I hug or touch. Some men, it may not have to be sex all the time. It can just be simply when you all see each other, it's giving a hug, holding hands, caressing the face, touching the neck, something along those lines. When you all hold hands, it may also be meaningful to him, a physical touch is his love language, that you and I sit close to each other. When y'all at home, like Camille talked about, for us, you know, sitting on the couch right next to each other means a lot to me. And then you getting a back rub or a massage from your spouse. And then lastly, you and your wife, you kiss frequently.
And these are the little things that lead up to the grand finale, right?
Yeah.
And I'm saying that because, ladies, sometimes we don't realize the way the society has portrayed men, we think that they are all just brute.
Yeah.
And they don't have emotion, and they don't like their bald head to be rubbed. We don't think that way.
Yeah.
So we're missing out on connecting with our spouse in a deeper way.
Yeah.
The Bible teaches us to go deeper. We should go deeper in the word and deeper in knowledge of who it is we chose to do life with.
Yeah.
Right? So physical touch for her. He and I hug or touch. We hold hands. He will kiss me frequently. These are things that the woman might like, gentlemen. He and I embrace after we've been apart for a while. He and I touch a lot during the normal course of the day. So walking past and patting her on the backside or holding her hand or putting your hand in the small part of her back or touching her shoulders. Those are things that are very necessary. And some of us want to get married. These are things you gotta know. You have to know these things because you are dealing with a human being, not a robot. And I say this to Pastor Monk often, like if he stubs his toe, and he'll make a big deal about it because he's very dramatic. You guys just don't see it. And
dramatic.
I'll say, you're very dramatic.
Okay.
And I'll say to him, are you joking? You were in Iraq. That don't hurt. And he'll say, I stubbed my toe. It does hurt.
I don't know why she just think like I'm some machine or something. Like, I'm just supposed to be the Energizer Bunny and nothing happens to me. I'm just supposed to keep on going. I thank you for your vote of confidence in me.
And because I have that mentality, I have to break myself from that. And he told me one day, a few years ago, he's like, I like when you touch my back, or I like when you hold my hand, because I had been in such work mode for years. I got to get this done. We got to get that done. My mind is only thinking about what needs to be done. It's not considering I have a partner with me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he has desires and needs that I need to fulfill. Because here's the big trick. If you ain't doing it,
somebody else
Somebody's waiting in the wing.
And also, Camille, let me say this, and then we're going to bring this to a close here. Physical touch in this manner in which you're talking about, not just about sex, can be a bit challenging. And I think it's for all of us, if this was not the love language that was a priority and clearly displayed when you were growing up.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us grew up in a household where our parents, the people who cared for us, never told us that they loved us. And so now to get to the place to start telling someone else that we're spending the rest of our lives with, to giving them that is challenging. If you never got a hug from your parent, auntie, uncle growing up, it can be difficult to be consciously aware of the fact that I need, when I see my spouse after he's been at work all day or she's been gone, to just come alongside and just hug her or hold her hand can be a bit of a challenge. But I want to say this to you, my brother, my sister, as we end this time together, that with God, there's nothing that's impossible.
Amen. Amen.
I think this is a perfect place for us just to stop. And I want to ask, if you would, to just bow your heads and close your eyes. Those of you who are married, would you hold the hand of your spouse or if you're someone you're seriously dating? And would you pray and ask God?
Hey, how you doing, family? Hopefully that time of teaching was encouraging to you. And you see, in between the time that we started out, we have a special guest.
A special
guest. Who is
guest?
Our special guest?
What's
would
your
you
name?
Tell us your name?
Winston.
Winston Monk. And so just so you all know, this is probably how you're getting, discovering your love language. You got this little barrier in a way that you're fighting with to get to your spouse. So we're grateful that we got Mr. Winston here with us.
And it's so good that he's here, actually, because when you're married and you have children, I think that sometimes we forget that just because they're in smaller bodies, that they don't notice things and they can't pick up on things. This little guy here has picked up on a lot of things that have gone on in our home, and he's called us out on a lot of things.
Absolutely.
And he's been able to, you know, just help us in growing together as husband and wife, as well as growing together as parents. So if you have little ones at home, married couples, watch what you say, watch how you treat your spouse, because they are watching and they are listening to everything.
Everything. So listen, I know we've spent quite a bit of time together this evening. We want to deal with a few questions that came up from people this evening. So one is, does your love language change? Does your love language change? And so I'm going to let Camille answer that. And then here's the other question that we have here. The other two, can a person have all of the love languages, and can a person have more than one love language? So you want to go ahead and answer that for us, Camille?
Okay, so first question, I think, was, does your love language change?
Yes.
And yes, as we know, as we grow older and, you know, experience life and go through different ups and downs and challenges, and, you know, we just gain more experience and we just grow, we change as human beings anyway. Yeah. So a lot of that, in that time, your love language begins to change. I think I talked about in the segment that when Raymond and I first met, my love language was time, quality time. Mm-hmm. But as time went on, it changed to acts of service, mm-hmm. and or changed to gifts. So yes, your love language can change. I think that, you know, it's important that you pay attention to you. And don't wait for your spouse to figure out your love language. That doesn't happen. Yeah. Only you can really, truly know and understand how you want to receive love. Mm-hmm. It happens often where we are waiting for people to affirm us and to tell us what we need for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And Raymond tells me, he's told me this often, I can't read your mind. You have to tell me what you want. And when we don't do that and we want them to just figure it out and we don't want to really let them know in a very direct way, it kind of harms and hinders the relationship, don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And then that other question was,
can a person have all of the love languages, and can a person have more than one love language?
So you can definitely have more than one. Some people have two, mm-hmm. and you can have all of them, but I'll say this, and if you read the book, Gary Chapman speaks on that. He says that you can have all of them, but you will usually have one or two that are more dominant than the other. Mm-hmm. So we'll go back to, there are five, words of affirmation, quality time, receiving gifts, acts of service, and physical touch. So you can have all of them, but there will be times in your life where one or two will be much more dominant than the other. So just, you know, watch out for that. There was something else that I wanted to really read and point out from the book. On page 182, Gary Chapman talks about, he goes through about 15 different questions, and it says, can love be reborn after sexual infidelity? And he says here, nothing devastates marital intimacy more than sexual unfaithfulness. Sexual intercourse is a bonding experience that unites two people in the deepest possible manner. But he says here, in the if you go down a little further, he says, however, this does not mean that the marriage is destined for divorce. Mm-hmm. If the offended party is willing to break off the extramarital involvement and do the hard work of rebuilding the marriage. I think that needs to be underlined, highlighted, and put some stars by it. Do the hard work of rebuilding the marriage, there can be genuine restoration. What do you feel about that?
Absolutely. I think this goes back to what we talked about last night. When you have infidelity in the union, it can take anywhere from about 9 months to about 18 months to just begin to get that trust back. And I want to say to those of you who may be watching, and infidelity unfortunately has happened in your marriage. Listen, if you're the person who was offended by the person who, your spouse was the one who stepped outside of the union, first of all, let me say to you, don't blame yourself for it. But in the midst of that, if you feel that this is the person whom God has given to you for you to spend the rest of your life with, and there's hope for the union to be restored, keep your standards high and don't lower your standards in any way at all. Because I know that sometimes the temptation is to lower your standards because you may feel empathy for that other person, but it's definitely possible for you to strengthen the union for you all to be able to move forward.
Good. That's very good advice. You know, I think the bottom line of tonight is really we wanted to really, really hone in on knowing yourself mm-hmm. first.
Yeah.
You have to know your love language. Mm-hmm. It's not your spouse's job to find that out. So when you really get in tune with who you are and who God created you to be, then you are able to express to your spouse how you need to be loved. And that's really what's important here.
Absolutely, absolutely. So listen, prayerfully this time together that we spent tonight has been helpful. I'm going to ask you that while you're still watching, if you would like and share this, that this might be helpful to others that you may know of this time, of this teaching. It's our prayer that this will help to strengthen marriages and also to inform those who are single of what it takes to love your spouse and the commitment that follows behind once you say, I do. Before we go, I want us to pray together. Would you bow your heads? And actually, if you're sitting with your spouse, would you mind grabbing her hand or bring the kids close and let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you now for all you've done for us. We thank you for your faithfulness and your loving kindness towards us. And we pray, Lord God, and ask you that you would be with every marriage that is watching this, whether it just be the husband or the wife or the two together. I pray that you would take what was shared this evening and that individuals would begin to apply it. I pray, Lord God, that you would help us to move past looking for our marriages to be based on performance as to deciding what and how we will respond. But help us, Lord God, and empower us by your Spirit to give our spouse the love that they rightfully need and deserve. We thank you for you doing these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. See you soon.
See you soon. Love you guys.